So this is a preliminary report on the long-term GPS carrier phase time transfer noise. Here is the outline of my presentation. First, I will give an introduction, and then I will show you the experimental setup and how we process the GPS data. And then I will give the results and discussions. So there are many time transfer techniques. So two popular time transfer techniques are GPS carrier phase time transfer and the two-way satellite time and frequency transfer, TWST-FT. So for GPS carrier phase time transfer, as we know that we have the GPS satellite transmits the signal, and the signal is essentially a carrier wave with coding. Okay, so this is what we get, the GPS satellite signal. And then for the receiver, it generates a replica signal. And by measuring the phase difference between the received satellite signal and the replica signal, we can determine the time difference between the GPS satellite clock and the GPS receiver time. Okay, so and then if we have another station and another GPS receiver at the other station, and we can also measure the time difference between the receiver time and the satellite time, and then we can get the time difference between one station and the other station. Okay, for two-way satellite time and the frequency transfer, is the concept is straightforward. We just send signal from A to B via geostationary satellite, and then B sends the signal back to A via the same satellite, and then we can get the time difference between A and B. Okay. So usually we assume that these two time transfer techniques give us the same result, but in practice they can be different. So here is the earlier paper last year by Victor Zhang, and also at NIST. Okay, so in that paper, we compared the UTC NIST against the UTC USNO using the two time transfer techniques. And then we do the double difference between the two techniques. And then we get the result shown by this curve. And you can see that the x-axis is MJD, and each division is 1 year. And for the y-axis is the difference between the two time transfer results. And you can see that for the past 2 years, the change is from -4.5 to -10.5. So that's actually 6 nanoseconds change during the past 2 years. And then the question is that we don't know whether it comes from GPS carrier phase or it comes from two-way or both. So for my purpose, I just check the GPS carrier phase and see how big it can change. But I don't study 2 years. I only study 100 days here. Okay, not 100 years. So for the GPS carrier phase time transfer, the noise it can come from satellite-related noise, such as the satellite clock and the satellite position, we have some uncertainty, and also the path-related noise, like tropospheric noise and ionospheric noise. And also we have the receiver-related noise, like multipath and the receiver noise and the cable noise. So usually for satellite-related noise and the path-related noise, since we monitor the satellite by many stations, and also for the path, we have some good estimation of the tropospheric zenith delay. So that these two types of noise can be averaged down after a few days. That's my opinion. So I don't know. But I think the receiver related noise is the main contributor to the long term noise in carrier phase. Okay. So that's why what we do is that we can use two receivers at the same station, and they have the same reference clock. So that everything is the same except that we use two setups. Okay. And then we can do the difference between these two. In this way, we can study the long-term noise in carrier phase time transfer. So here is the experimental setup, and we have seven NIST receivers. Three receivers are located at zone A, and four receivers are located at zone B. And this is a Google map of NIST. And so C is a penthouse, just for your reference, and D is a building. Okay, so we now let's this slide shows you the receiver models and the antenna models of all the seven NIST receivers, and they are from Novotel, Hashtag, and Substantial. And for antennas, some of them are choke ring and some of them are pinwheel. Okay. So now let's see. We have all the GPS data, and so how do we process those GPS data? The NRCAM PPP one day is a standard kind of standard processing method, and it processes one day of GPS data. And this method is widely used in both navigation and time transfer communities. So the disadvantage is that it has a day bounded discontinuity, and because we have some uncertainty in estimating the phase ambiguity. So usually it is as big as like 100 picoseconds to 500 picoseconds. I will show you some plots later for the day bounded discontinuity. And so then, in order to solve the day bounded discontinuity, people proposed the NRCAM PPP 30 days or multi-days, 35 days. And it processes 30 days of GPS data, and it is also widely used. And its disadvantage is that we still have a jump between the first 30 days and the second 30 days. And then in 2014, we proposed the revised readiness shift method. This one processes, essentially it processes a data batch of GPS data, like here. We process the GPS data for like maybe 10 days. And then we extract the middle point, middle epoch, and then we process another data batch. That starts 10 minutes later and ends 10 minutes later, and then we extract the middle point, and we collect all these middle points, and then that's the revised readiness shift result. Okay. So this technique is a new technique. So we want to compare it a little bit with the other tools so that the result is more reliable. And its advantage is, of course, we designed to remove the boundary discontinuity. So here, this plot shows you the result using RRS, the revised readiness shift method. And we use all the seven NIST receivers, and at the beginning I just shifted them to be zero for better comparison. And you can see that so we compare UTC NIST against the IGS time. IGS time is just similar to GPS time. GPS system time is just a time scale reference time. So it doesn't matter. We just do the same comparison using seven NIST receivers, and you can see that the result is slightly, essentially they are the same, but if you look carefully, you can see that they are not exactly the same. For example, here, it is maybe like 0.4 nanoseconds, and here it is maybe 0.9 nanoseconds. So and then we enlarge the figure, we just enlarge this figure and see more details, and you can see that the biggest difference at this is about 30 days from the beginning of the curve. And you can see that the biggest difference is about 0.4 nanosecond. And after about 90 days, the biggest difference is about 0.7 nanoseconds. And you may wonder that the curves just diverge linearly as time goes. But in fact, that the noise is kind of like a random work. And so you can see that NISY, the sine curve here, is above the red curve, NISA. So it is above it at this moment. And after like 60 days, it is the sine curve is below the red curve. So it's just a random walk. And then we do the double difference. We do the difference between the curves. So we do the difference between, for example, NISX and NISY. Okay. And then we get this result. This tells us the relative change of the two receivers. And we can see that during the about 100 days, the relative change can be as big as 0.7 nanoseconds. Okay. So at this moment, you may wonder whether RS is working properly or not. And we compare it with NRCAM PVP. Okay. So this is the comparison. And we can see that NRCAM PVP one day has a lot of day boundary discontinuities, and so RS gives us a much better monitor of the relative time change between two receivers. Okay, and then you may say NRCAM PVP 30 days will work better. So it is better than NRCAM PVP one day, and you can see that there is no day boundary discontinuity. Instead, there are a few 30 days boundary discontinuity. You can see here. So I process it somewhere here, and then we process 30 days, and another 30 days, another 30 days. Okay, so there are three jumps in NRCAM PVP 30 days. And RS has a good match with NRCAM PVP 30 days. For example, here, there is a dip here, and there is a bump here, so there is a big peak here, and both of them have similar patterns, but RS is better than NRCAM PVP because it removes the jumps. Okay. So, and then this plot shows you the Allen deviation, the modified total deviation of all the three methods, the three curves. One is RS, the other two are NRCAM PVP one day and NRCAM PVP 30 days. And you can see that RS has the same short-term stability as NRCAM PVP 30 days here. And then it has better long-term stability than NRCAM PVP 30 days just because it removes the jumps. So from this plot, we know that usually the two receivers can give us about 0.75 nanoseconds difference in 100 days. Then that's the typical situation, and we want to know that how good we can achieve. This plot shows you the smallest long-term noise we can achieve. So in about 100 days, the time transfer difference between these two receivers is less than 0.3 nanoseconds. So that's the best we can achieve peak to peak. Okay. So there is a jump here. That's due to, in both methods, that's due to the data anomaly. A later result will show you that this one will be removed, but I don't have the plot here. So anyway, there is still a jump here and a jump here. So okay. So this plot shows you the smallest long-term noise we can achieve. And then this plot shows you the largest long-term noise we may have. So here is NIST time minus NISY time, and you can see that in about 1 month, the change is very, very big. It's about 1.3 nanoseconds, and then it becomes pretty stable. So if we do calibration somewhere here, then after 30 days, we may be 1.3 nanoseconds away. So that's a conclusion. So different GPS receivers give different time transfer results, and the typical difference is usually 500 picoseconds in 100 days. The smallest one can be 300 picoseconds. The largest one is maybe 1.3 nanoseconds if we are not lucky. So RS allows us to see the relative time change between two receivers more clearly. And so we plan to do a longer term comparison, for example, 1 year or 2 years. And so if you are interested in the program, you can contact me or Judah. Thank you.